A two-part series, although last week we didn't know it was a two-part series. Come on, somebody. That was something that barely figured out today because it went so long. So we saved the second part for today. But it was called Following God, Spiritual Authority, and the Voice of the Spirit, looking at Paul's farewell address to the Ephesian elders. And of course, this is everybody's favorite topic that we talked about last week, was submission to spiritual authority. Everyone loves to submit to authority, right? Am I right, men's home? But anyway, in Acts 19, remember there's a riot in Ephesus, and Paul traveled to Macedonia and Greece, right? And so he's coming back on his way to Jerusalem. The Bible says he's actually in a hurry to get to Jerusalem, and so he passed by Ephesus, right? But he had called for the Ephesian elders. He called for the churches that he had planted there. He called for them, said, hey, come over to Miletus and meet me. You know what I mean? And we looked that they actually got up and they went to meet Paul, right? They didn't say, who does this dude think he is? Why doesn't he come to my city? I'm not going out of my way to go see him. No, they got up and they went because they understand that Paul was their spiritual authority, right? And so when they got there, what ended up happening is that Paul ended up having the farewell address to the Ephesian elders. This is very popular among pastors, right? When he arrives there, this is the first thing he says. We're going to read the scripture. So they arrive there in Miletus with Paul the apostle, and let's all stand out of respect for God's word. We're going to read a few verses here, Acts 20:17-25, and it goes like this: From Miletus, Paul sent to Ephesus for the elders of the church. When they arrived, he said to them, "You know how I lived the whole time I was with you from the first day I came into the province of Asia. I served the Lord with great humility, with tears, and in the midst of severe testing, trials, by the plots of my Jewish opponents. You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus." Everybody say, one way. Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit. Everybody say, compelled by the Spirit. I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and to complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. So Lord, we just pray, God, Lord, your blessing upon your word this morning. Lord, we pray that you would speak to hearts today, that you would have your way, God, that you would surround this sanctuary with a wall of fire, God, that your glory would be revealed today, God. Lord, we thank you, God, Lord, for your faithfulness over this past year. God, Lord, today we celebrate you and what you've done over the past year and this one-year anniversary of this church. God, Lord, that you raised up this church for such a time as this, in Jesus' name, amen. Look at your neighbor and say, welcome to the house of God. And then raise your hands like this. Everybody raise your hands like this and look up and say, God, speak to my heart and change my life. You may be seated in Jesus' name. So it's interesting right here, one of the first things he says, I don't know why this keeps going off. I need a technical person. It keeps going blank. It keeps going off. It keeps going back. Anyway, I got it. So right here he says, you know how I have how I lived. You know, so right here we see that Paul had a good reputation, you know what I mean, among believers. They all knew how he lived. He lived with these people. They knew that Paul was the real deal. It says he served the Lord with great humility, with tears, and in the midst of trials, right? That he served the Lord with humility, with many tears. He would weep over people. And then he goes on to say, I have not hesitated to preach the whole word of God, both publicly and from house to house. So we see that Paul was not an individual that pick and chose popular parts of the gospel, huh? He didn't pick just what people wanted to hear in his community. He spoke about repentance. He spoke about judgment, huh? He spoke about heaven. He spoke about hell. How many know some people don't want to hear about hell nowadays? Do you know that Jesus talks more about hell than he does about heaven? You know that, right? So people don't want to hear about that. You know, they don't want to hear about the baptism in the Holy Spirit. They don't want to hear about speaking in tongues. They don't want to hear about miracles because that's weird stuff. Come on, somebody. But Paul wasn't ashamed. Come on. He wasn't ashamed to proclaim the whole counsel of God. And see, because Paul knew this, that he was accountable to God for what he said. See, Paul was accountable to God for what he said. You know what I mean? So if Paul said something that didn't line up with the word of God, then the blood was going to be on his hand at the end of the days when he stands before God. So I want to ask you guys, do we proclaim the whole word of God? Do we claim everything that's in the Bible or just the parts that we like? Huh? Just the parts that we were taught as kids. Just the part that we learned in our this church or that church. Or do we proclaim the whole counsel of God in love, but the whole counsel, the truth in love. See, he told everyone, he says, I told everyone, Jews and Gentiles, that there was one way to heaven, and that was through Jesus Christ, right? He said, I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God and repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. See, there's one passage of scripture that says all of Israel will be saved. So there's actually some people that actually teach that Jews will be saved apart from Jesus Christ. But yeah, so that's right. No way. So you see right here that Paul's saying, I told Jews and Gentiles and Greeks, there's one way to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. And so Paul says, he goes on to say that, you know what? You must turn to God in repentance and have faith in Jesus Christ. So we see that repentance is a change of heart. It's a change of mind, and it's a change of direction. You know what I mean? When you repent, that means you change the way you think about something, change your thinking, and change your direction, huh? You know what I mean? You change the way you feel about your sin and about the life that you're living and how you're living your life before God, and you go in a different direction. So it's impossible to claim to be a Christian if you are not following the Lord in obedience and in a personal relationship. The Bible says in Matthew 7, 21 through 23, and we quote this a lot at the altar calls, but it says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. Only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. Obedience matters. Come on. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not drive out demons in your name? Did we not perform miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, ye that work iniquity, or you evil doers, right? So he'll say that he never knew them. You know what I mean? And that know you from the Greek is to have a personal, intimate relationship and knowledge of. It's not just to know about Jesus. We don't want to just know a bunch of facts about Jesus. We're in the Bible Belt, y'all. A lot of people know a lot about Jesus. There's no lack of knowing a lot about Jesus. What there's a lack of is actually knowing him intimately, knowing him personally, walking with him, talking with him, walking in obedience to his commands. So we know that we're not saved by works. How many know that? I'm not claiming we are. Nothing you've ever done and nothing you ever will do will save you. That was only on the cross of Calvary when Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay, that you could never pay. You can't add to that. You can't take away from that. We're only saved through our faith in Jesus Christ and the sacrifice and him paying the penalty for us on the cross of Calvary. Come on. But see, when you have true repentance, your life will change. It will change. Now, I'm not saying you're going to live it out perfectly. Come on, I think some of you know my story. I was living for Jesus. I was a pastor. I fell on my face. I went back to my old life, went back to prison. You know what I mean? So that's not what I'm saying. We will. You don't have to. I didn't have to fall. That wasn't God's will that I went back to my old life. That was my stupid choices. Come on, somebody. Can I get a minute? But God saw grace, had grace, and picked me up even after I fell. So watch this. Satan's first move in the garden was to dethrone the ruler and the master, Lord God, right? Every scripture in reference to God in relation to Adam is Lord God. So anytime you read the word Lord, L-O-R-D, and it's all in caps, that is the name translated from the Hebrew, Yahweh, right, which is used of God. Yahweh is a proper name referring to the God of Israel. It's translated Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D in our Bibles. Elohim, the word God there, is actually a generic word for God. So Yahweh, the word Lord, that's translated Lord in the first parts of Genesis, is used when the Bible stresses his personal relationship with his people or the ethical character of his nature. So, but Yahweh is used in his relationship. So it's used to his personal nature and how he relates to us personally as human beings. So it emphasizes his immanence, that God is near his creation, huh? That God is active in our lives. See, some people say God's real, but he's not active in our lives, right? Deism. God is a big God, the big watchmaker in the sky. He made this and then bounced. But how many know that's not true? God is active in our lives. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Elohim refers to God's power as the creator God, shows God's power as the creator, right? Transcendent, above and beyond, right? Powerfully and wholly independent of material universe, right? But in Genesis 2, 4 through 3:23, he uses Lord God, Yahweh Elohim. Everyone say Yahweh Elohim. That shows the very intimate and detailed relationship between God and Adam. Both names, Lord God, used to show that the same Elohim that created the universe is also has a personal relationship with those that walk with him. How cool is that? So anytime you read Lord in all caps, it's Yahweh. It means master, ruler, savior, right? So when Satan spoke to Eve, how many remember in chapter 3 of Genesis, spoke to Eve about eating the forbidden fruit, right? He did not refer to, that's when it changes from Yahweh Elohim to just Elohim. And he said, did God really say? Huh? So see what happened is Satan stripped the word Lord, removing master and absolute absolute ruler, right, from the word, right? So he was removing the Lord that was in relationship to man, right? So Satan, check this out, watch this. Satan sought to reduce the relationship of Eve to God to one of just creator, not Lord. No intimate relationship, no lordship. Right, so Satan, watch this, and he's still doing it today. He wanted to have the concept of religion while eliminating relationship and divine authority. So Satan wanted to keep the concept of religion without relationship and without divine authority. So what happened is by removing Lord from the equation, the authoritative nature and the relationship that God had with Adam and Eve, Satan bypassed that, causing humankind not only to rebel, but to lose the dominion that was supposed to be that they were supposed to have over the earth. So man was created to have dominion over the earth, but Satan came and stole that from man, because we cannot exercise authority unless it's under God. There is no true, we don't have authority unless it's exercised under God's authority. So religion without rulership, of Yahweh was Satan's tactic from the beginning. And get this, Jesus was God's ultimate revelation of who he was. He came in, he put on flesh, right? He put on flesh. He came to earth. He humbled himself, became obedient even to death on the cross to reveal himself to us. So, but now we see Satan doing the same thing today, huh? You know, everybody is cool when you believe in God. If you believe in a creator God, that's cool. You know what I mean? You can believe in any God you want. You can believe in Buddha. You can believe in Allah, huh? You know what I mean? You can believe in self or humanism. You know what I mean? You could even believe in Satan, and that's cool. You have your right to believe in Satan. But watch this. You start talking about Jesus Christ as the only way to heaven, and you will get pushback from the culture. People aren't going to be happy about that. You know what I mean? You're not going to get a pat on the back for that. Come on, somebody. Because it is a spiritual battle. We are in a spiritual battle, and the lives and the eternal souls of men and women lay in the balance. See, but the Bible is clear. Following Jesus means submitting to his authority and having a relationship with him. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10 says that for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, this not of yourselves. It is a gift from God, not by works, so that no man can boast. But we are God's workmanship. You are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he created in advance for you to do. So we're not saved by works, but we are saved for works. Come on, somebody. You know, you doing something won't save you. But when you're saved, God's got a plan for your life. He's got some stuff for you to do. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. So the next point I want to talk about, and this is the point we're gonna focus on today, is compelled by the Spirit. And right here in Acts 20, verse 22 and 23, it says, when I returned to Jerusalem and was praying at the temple, I fell into a trance. And I saw, no, that's not the right one. Acts 20, verse 22 and 23. I'll just read it. Acts 20, 22 and 23, it says like this, and now compelled by the Spirit, everybody say compelled by the Spirit. I am going to Jerusalem not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. So he was moved by the Spirit to go to Jerusalem. In Acts 20, it even says he was in a hurry. He was in a hurry to get to Jerusalem, even knowing that prison and hardships awaited him. So it wasn't whether he was going to be comfortable or have an effective ministry, but it was in obedience to the Spirit that he went. The word compelled by the Spirit is translated in the NLT. Some of you guys maybe have different versions, but in the NLT, it's translated bound by the Spirit. In the ESV, it says constrained by the Spirit. Huh? In the NRV, it says captive to the Spirit. You know, Jesus or Paul considered himself a slave. Do you remember that? He said, I'm a slave. I'm a slave to Christ. How many know? Remember Dr. Hosfeld preached a sermon a while ago and he said, hey, you got to serve somebody. Come on, somebody. You're either going to serve God or you're going to serve Satan. So there's only two ways, right? Compelled, the definition means to secure by force, to force to submit, to overpower. You know what I mean? So Paul was actually voluntarily submitted himself to the will of the Father and was moved by the Spirit to go to Jerusalem. So we believe that the Holy Spirit speaks today. How many believe that? The Holy Spirit still speaks today. God is a speaking God. And you know, this morning, and God does this, and some of you are going to know exactly what I'm talking about, but I was doing devotions before going over my message, before coming to church this morning, and I was reading in Oswald Chambers, My Utmost for His Highest, which I read many mornings, you know? And so the verse at the top for today was this one, Acts 20, verse 24, so that I may finish the race with joy and the ministry which I have received from the Lord Jesus. Isn't that powerful? That's what I'm talking about today, and that just happened to be in the devotions that I read this morning. Don't you love when God does stuff like that? He just confirms you're on the right way. Hey, you know, when we first started this church, this is the year anniversary. You know, a year ago on March 6th when we started this church, and I was praying about what to do as far as a series, and I felt like we should go with Acts, right? And so I think it was the second or third Sunday. You know, the second or third Sunday, I was about to start the series in the book of Acts. And so I was like, how many people? They were giving me the count of how many people were at church. And remember, how many were there? 120. Remember that, you guys? 120. And I'm like, for me, it was like, that's confirmation. This is the series I'm supposed to go on. And see, I had just been studying the night before that 120, how many people were in the upper room when the Spirit was poured out? 120. Did you also know this, that historically, for the Jews, in the context of Jews, to start a new community, you needed 120 people. So I felt like God was actually, that was God giving his affirmation that we were starting a new community of faith right here at CityReach Springfield. Come on. And so God speaks through different ways. Sometimes you're reading the Bible and God will bring it alive to you. You know what I mean? You're reading a word and God will bring it alive to you. Sometimes God will speak to you through dreams. Sometimes through visions, right? Sometimes through that inner voice, right? That comes to your mind. It comes to your mind and you know it's God. God can even speak in an audible voice. He spoke to people through angels before. So prophecy. Right? We believe that God can speak through prophecy. In Acts 13, it says, while the believers were in fasting and prayer, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul to the work to which I have called them. Right? So they were in prayer and fasting, and someone probably had a prophetic word, and it came out, and so they sent them out. You know, and we can talk more about that, but I just want you to know that when you're in submission to the authority of God, you know what I mean? When you're walking in an intimate relationship with God, you can trust when the Spirit speaks to you. When the Spirit speaks, but if you're not, then you got to be careful. And here's another thing. We're not saying there's ever going to be any new revelation. So that the Bible is, that's it. That's all. There's not going to have new revelation. You know what I mean? A new way to heaven. You know what I mean? Or anything like that. There's not going to be new revelation, but there is going to be direction. So if you look in the Bible, is the Bible going to tell you whether to go to Evangel or MSU? Where are you going to find that? Maccabees 7:9? You know what I mean? It's not in there. It's not in there. So when you want specific direction for your life, sometimes as you're reading the Bible, God will actually drop it on you, which direction, you know what I mean, that you're supposed to go. It's the voice of the Spirit, but it will never contradict the written word of God. So Paul pressed on, following the leading of the Spirit, even though it meant hardship, prison, and eventually death. He would get taken from Jerusalem and chained to Rome, where he would be beheaded by Nero. Right? So sometimes following Jesus and you'll be blessed. Blessed financially even. You know what I mean? So that you can turn, could be a blessing to the kingdom. But check this out. Sometimes you'll be blessed, but you'll lose your job. Come on, somebody. Sometimes following Jesus will cause you to lose your job. Sometimes following Jesus will cause people at your job to come against you. Come on, David. Sometimes Jesus may tell you to sell everything you have and give it to the poor. But see, this goes against our Western version of Christianity, where ease and comfort has become our God. We think that if there is any discomfort, if there is any opposition, then it can't be from God. It's got to be the devil. Come on, somebody. We think if we can't get the parking spot right in front at Walmart, that the devil is attacking us. Lying devil. But come on, maybe God is actually moving, but he wants you to park far away so you can get some exercise when you walk to, come on, somebody. So Paul stepped out, even though the only for sure was that he was headed for a struggle. Other church folk tried to convince him not to go to Jerusalem. We'll look at this next week. But other people were like, don't go. You know what I mean? You're going to get locked up if you go there. You know what I mean? You're going to go to prison. They're going to beat you. You know what I mean? And Paul says, hey, you know what I mean? I don't care about all that. My only thing is to finish the race of the task that God has given me of proclaiming the good news. They may have told him, don't go to that CityReach church. They're crazy over there. They're going to try to get you to evangelize. They're going to try to get you to give of your finances. They're going to try to get you to give of your time. They're going to try to get you to be on the security team, and you don't got time for that. You got to get home and have dinner. You don't have time to be on the security team. Come on, somebody. But see, we want to be a church where you get involved. This is going to be a church where you're not going to be comfortable just to come in and just sit on the pew. It's not pastor's job to go out and reach the lost of our community. It's us as a community's job to go out and reach this community. Come on. We want to encourage people to participate in God's mission to reach the one far from Him. See, Paul responded, I'm ready not only to get locked up, but I am prepared to die for the sake of the gospel in obedience to Jesus Christ. So this is interesting. We see in Acts 22:17 that years before, right after Paul's conversion, he went to Jerusalem and began speaking, right? And while he was there, it says, when I returned to Jerusalem and when I was praying at the temple, I fell into a trance and saw the Lord speaking to me. Quick, he said, leave Jerusalem immediately because the people here will not accept your testimony about me. So when he first got saved, he was speaking in Jerusalem, and the Holy Spirit said, hey, get out of here. They're going to try to kill you here. And then in Acts 18:9-11, we see, you guys remember this a few weeks ago, that when he was in Corinth preaching, there was a lot of opposition. But one night the Lord spoke to him in a vision and said, don't be afraid. Speak out. Don't be silent. I am with you. No one will attack you or harm you. I have many people in this city. And then it says, so Paul stayed in Corinth for a year and a half. So sometimes God led him in the same city where he's now telling him to go back, where he's going to experience hardships, where he's going to be locked up. You know what I mean? Years before, God had told him, get up and move out of that city because they're going to try to kill you. So sometimes God told Paul to get out of a city. You know what I mean? Because they're going to try to kill you. Other times he said, stay in the city. I'll be with you. They're not going to kill you. And then in this passage of Scripture, he's telling them, go into the city. They're going to lock you up, and they're going to eventually kill you. And so, but Paul does it. Why? Not because of what, because so God could give a different direction at different times. We got to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Right here, you're saying go and you will face hardship. Other times he's saying get out of here because they're going to attack you. So we wanted the ultimate goal for us should be obedience to the Holy Spirit. So Acts 20, Paul, the Spirit compels Paul to go to Jerusalem where he will face hardship and prison. So comfort and what in the natural we would consider the best is not always God's leading. If comfort, you know what I mean? If comfort and, you know what I mean, security is your primary goal, don't go plant a church. You don't go plant a church. If that's your primary goal, go out and start a business and do that. Don't go plant a church because it's going to be hard. It's going to be hard. To the church planters here, they've heard the call of God to go and do what He's told them to do. And there's no bones about it. It's going to be hard. There's going to be many nights when you're up praying, when you're up weeping, you know what I mean, for your city. You know what I mean? When people come against you, when they come against your family, and you have to know at that point that I'm being obedient to God, that you can say along with Paul, you know what I mean? I'm ready not only to be locked up. I'm ready not only to have people stab me in the back, but I'm ready to die for the cause of Jesus Christ. And so if you feel that way, then it doesn't matter what people say. It doesn't matter what people do, right? Because we need to live our lives for an audience of one. That's why the greatest command is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. The second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. But our first goal is to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Then we can actually love our neighbor correctly. And it won't matter. You know what I mean? See, that's where it's good to help people, but there's a lot of humanitarian if God's not the central focus, you can get sidetracked. So we want to keep God as we do what we do because first of all and foremost because we love God and we do it in obedience to Him. So maybe there's people in this room today, God's calling you to go plant a church. Come on, somebody. God's calling you to go out with the street witnessing team this Saturday. Come on. Go out and go out with Pastor Tom and hit the streets. And you know what's amazing is on Friday night, we had a woman a few weeks ago. Our team went out armed with roses, McDonald's gift cards, and the love of Jesus Christ, and went out handing one lady, Tom was saying, one lady said, I was praying for McDonald's today, and God gave me McDonald's because we handed out gift cards. Come on, that's powerful. Friday night fire, there was a lady there with her newborn baby, and she was one of those ladies that got a rose, that someone prayed for her, and she showed up at church. So that's powerful. I encourage you to get out of the boat. How many know the only people that walk on water are the ones that actually get out of the boat? You know what? I really believe this. I believe that at the end of our lives, when we stand before God, you know what I mean? One of our biggest regrets is when we realize how much we could have done for the cause of Christ and we didn't. How much more we could have done. Now, we're forgiven. We're going to heaven. But I believe we'll have regrets when we learn that this is what God wanted us to do. And we didn't do it. We didn't step out of the boat. We were too focused on this life. We got blinded by the temporal things of this life instead of going after the things that really matter. So we're a church on mission in the power of the Holy Spirit. So God still speaks today. You know what I mean? People that say that God does not speak today, that he stopped speaking with the apostles, that's something completely foreign to what we read throughout the whole of Scripture. God is a speaking God. In the beginning, God said, come on, somebody. And he's still speaking until the end of days, until he says, I am coming soon, until he says, well done, good and faithful servant. So, you know, I've been through a long process. You know what I mean? People look at me and Hannah, and maybe they say, how did they get here? Where did they come from? You know what I mean? And they say, don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I've been here, LL Cool J, am I old? Don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. A few of the older guys were waving at me. All right. So, but not too old, because we're not that old. The old guys didn't get it, and the young guys didn't get it. So don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. Anyway, sometimes when you're writing up messages, something that seems like it's going to be really funny, it ends up not being funny at all, but that's okay. You know what I mean? We through many sufferings, we enter the kingdom. Okay. So for me to go from dope dealer slanging drugs for the cartels to a convicted felon to shooting up dope behind a dumpster on a cardboard box to graduating from college to being a missionary to the Philippines, huh? To graduating with a master's degree to being the father to the most beautiful baby in the world and the husband to the most amazing wife in the world. What did I say? And so but you know what I mean? So, and to the most amazing congregation. How many know you guys are the most amazing congregation in the Ozarks? Come on. Man, they clapped harder there than for the rest of my points. Just kidding. So I'm thankful that the Lord has led me along the way. And sometimes I followed the Lord with complete obedience. And at other times I failed. But God has been faithful. So how did I get from there to here? So I just want to share in the remaining time that we have here, just a few key times that when God has spoke to my life. You know what I mean? How God met me on the way. When I was 4 years old, my parents were missionaries to Mexico and Costa Rica. And we were actually at Disneyland. We were back in Southern California and went to Disneyland. And I'm 4 years old, and we're at a little shooting gallery some of you guys have heard this, where you shoot the light out of the end of the rifle. Right, you shoot the light out of the end of the rifle, you put quarters in or nickels, whatever we used back then, wooden nickels. But you knocked off light, you knocked the things over in the saloon. How many know what I'm talking about? So right there, my parents ended up leaving me, right, because I wouldn't go. They said, let's go, and I said no. You know, I've always been a little rebellious, even at 4 years old. So I said no, and I stayed there, and so they left and took off to Tom Sawyer Island, which nowadays they probably get locked up for doing that, child abuse and stuff. But back then, they just laughed, said, whatever, you know what I mean, stubborn kid, left me there, so I'm shooting and having fun. And then I realized that if you don't have money in the machine, you no longer have light going out, so I'm missing everything because there's no light actually going out to knock stuff over in the saloon. So I go back and I get underneath a little, there was a little tree, a little grassy area there across from the saloon. And this is one of the only, this is one of the vivid memories, only vivid memories I have from that age. But I was looking over at the saloon, and I felt the presence of a being. I felt the presence of God. And then I asked Jesus to come into my heart, 4 years old. Come on, Grandma, Grandma, getting it. Give the Lord a hand clap. And then my parents didn't believe it because they didn't believe that God could actually encounter a rebellious kid like me. That's true. That's what my dad said. But anyway, so at 6 years old, we were actually at Lakewood Church in Houston, Texas. My parents were back from Costa Rica. We were at Lakewood Church in Houston, Texas, where the pastor's name was John Osteen. And so at that time, you know what I mean? What I and this is my next vivid memory, was that we were at a service. And I remember John Osteen walking back and forth, speaking on a pulpit, right? And you know what I mean? And the atmosphere was electrified with the presence of God. And God said, one day you're going to do that. And it's powerful. Now, John Osteen is the father of Joel Osteen. John Osteen was completely different than Joel Osteen. Come on, somebody. Sometimes the apple falls a long ways from the tree. But anyway, I don't want to offend any Joel Osteen fans, but I'm just that's the truth. And so... So you know what, in 1996, after dropping multiple dirty urines for the PO, how many, can I get a witness, how many know how that is? You know what I mean? So the PO said I needed to go to a long-term patient, inpatient program. I'd already been to Wickenburg, Arizona to the Meadows, which is like $45,000 a month, and I got high on the airplane back home. I got drunk and then got high when I landed. You know what I mean? Didn't do any good. So the PO says, you need long-term inpatient program. So my dad found Teen Challenge in Spokane, Washington. And I went to Spokane, Washington to Teen Challenge. And it was actually a pig farm. So I was working with pigs all day long, talking about I hated it. You know what I mean? I was there for like 2 months, got up and left and went back to Albuquerque. You know what I mean? But when I got back to Albuquerque, I started using drugs, but God had started to move upon my life. Because I remember I was walking around, when I got back to Albuquerque, walking around grocery stores, and the conviction of the Holy Spirit was so strong upon my life. And I heard, everywhere I went, I heard people talking about Jesus. And that doesn't happen a lot in Albuquerque, you know what I mean? People were talking about Jesus. I was like, this is a little bit weird. And then I remember I was driving in my car down Lead and Yale, the one way that goes to Yale Street, right there where I used to sell drugs, you know what I mean, for many years. And as we were driving up, I saw bumper stickers on cars. There was three cars in front of me on this one-way street, and they all had a Jesus-type bumper sticker, a little fish, Jesus lives, some more stuff. You know what I mean? And so I'm like, what is going on? And I just felt the conviction. I came around the corner and I saw a billboard, which had been right up there in the hood for many years, put up there by the Catholic Church. But it was just a billboard that had the Jesus, a huge Jesus, with his arms wide open. I came around that corner, I saw that, and it was like, man, just a heavy conviction. I don't know how to put it in words, but it was just a physical, tangible conviction of the Holy Spirit. The arrows of God were penetrating my heart. So I pulled over, and I said, God, I said, if this is you, leave me alone. It's very sad, but that's what I said. And so, but you know what? Several years later, you know what I mean? I 22 years from the time when I saw John Osteen speak and God said, this is going to be you one day. 22 years later, on the run for attempted murder, I walked into that little recovery home in Phoenix, Arizona, and there God met me. I had peace. I had purpose for the first time in my life. And then several months later, this would have been January of 1999, there was a Men of Conviction conference It was a conference for the rehab homes in the southwest of the United States for Victory Outreach. So we went to this rehab conference, and at that rehab conference, there was the first night, the message was by a guy named Philip LaCruz Sr., and he had the message, and at the end of the message, he said, "All of you who feel the call of God upon your lives to full-time ministry." Hallelujah, Lois. Let's give Grandma Lois a hand. How many have been? Priscilla. Lois is her daughter. So this is Priscilla. She's. How many of you know Priscilla from the prison? How many ever heard her speak? Come on. Yeah. So we used to go into the OCC together. So glad you're here.
They don't know Priscilla. They know Grandma.
Grandma. This is Grandma, everybody. Grandma. Affectionately known as Grandma to the convicts. So you know what, right there at that conference, you know what I mean? They said, "Those called to full-time ministry, come forward." And I'm talking, everybody went forward. And I've shared this before, but I'm talking everyone went forward. Even the guys still smoking cigarettes at the recovery home. Come on, somebody. Even the guys sneaking off to use the phone to call their girlfriends. Oh, come on, somebody. So there was, so you know what? These guys weren't serious. And I had a genuine encounter with God, and I wasn't doing that stuff. And I was a little self-righteous. Come on, somebody. So I was just, you know what I mean? I wasn't doing that stuff. So I figured, these guys, there's no way God's calling these guys to full-time ministry. You know what I mean? And they were all flooding forward. So I prayed and I said, "God," I said, if this is you speaking to me, then I'm going to need to hear it from you. You know what I mean? I'm not going to go up there because some man called me forward. I need to know this is you. And I can see myself sitting in that pew to today, this morning, many years ago, and I felt the presence of God come upon me, and I began to weep. And I began to cry like I never had before in my life. I was hunched over. It was a deep weep from deep within my spirit. And I wasn't really a crier, so I never really cried. So I pushed everything inward, which was actually worse. So I said, "Yes, God," and I got down, and I walked down to that altar. You know what I mean? And as I walked down to that altar, I saw with my natural eyes what seemed to be a haze, like a fog at that altar. And when I walked into it, I began to speak in a language that I had never learned before. It was just flowing out of me. I began to speak in tongues, you know, a prayer language. I began to spoke in tongues for 3 days. You know what I mean? I remember one thing I remember about that is I was consumed with love. You know what I mean? During that season. And I've shared this before too, but on our way back, so we got in the 15-passenger van to head back to Phoenix from Glorieta, New Mexico. And I'm talking a van full of some smelly dudes that been in the cabins for 3 days. And I remember sitting back there, and I'm just consumed with the love. And I said, "I love you guys." And these guys were like, "We love you too." You know what I mean? So I just remember being consumed with a love and a fresh empowerment. So if you can love 15 guys in a men's home van after 3 days in a cabin, how many know that's got to be God working in your life? And so a few months later, we went to Little Rock, Arkansas. So there was a crusade. The ministry that I was affiliated with, Victory Outreach, was doing a crusade in Little Rock, Arkansas. So I'd been in the home at this point about 5 months. And so I went to Little Rock, Arkansas, and my job was to work washing dishes in downtown Little Rock. I would wash dishes for 8 hours a day, you know what I mean, to help support the recovery home and then also for this crusade that we were about to have. And so I remember just going in there day after day, and I'm talking, before I found Jesus, you couldn't pay me to wash dishes. Come on, somebody. You can't. My wife might say you still can't. But anyway, I wouldn't wash dishes because, first of all, there's no way that I would be able to support my habit washing dishes. They don't pay $1,000 a day to wash dishes. If you know of a spot, I'll go wash dishes. But the thing of it was is that, and also I was kind of proud. But here I am not getting paid nothing. Just washing dishes, just grateful to God, washing dishes, you know. And I remember one afternoon as I was there, and I heard the voice of God. So to me, it was audible. To me, I heard it with my ears. But this is what God said. He said, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord, feed my sheep." He said that 3 times. And I'm talking, it was like a waterfall. It was like, it was this overwhelming voice of God that came to me. So much that, you know what, I was trembling, and I looked around afterwards to see if everyone else heard it, you know what I mean, and no one else heard it. You know what I mean? But I believe at that point, I was only 6 months in the home or whatever it was, but I believe that was my mandate. And now I've learned what that meant. I didn't know that that was a quotation for John the Baptist from Isaiah 40. I didn't know that feed my sheep was where Peter, you know what I mean? After he backslid, he was restored, and they say he was called in, you know, back in to go into ministry. You know what I mean? I didn't know any of that. All I knew is I heard the voice of God, and now that has become my mandate for ministry. And then, you know what? After I graduated the recovery home, right? I was director of the recovery home. And then I went to the School of Ministry in downtown Los Angeles. And while we were there, they used to wake us up. So maybe we should start doing this, Tom, too. So it was an urban training center. But about 1 a.m. on some weekends, after you'd already been asleep, they would wake you up for evangelism time. How many know? Sometimes you're excited about it, sometimes not so much. Come on. But so they would wake you up. It's time to evangelize. Load up in the shuttle. You know what I mean? That night we went out to Skid Row. I mean, hundreds of people on cardboard boxes, smoking crack. You know what I mean? The homeless there. And then we went to Santa Monica Pier. And when we went to Santa Monica Pier, and by this time it was already closed down, but there were still people that would hang around, so we were witnessing, you know what I mean, to people. And I got separated from the group, and as I was walking along Santa Monica Pier, it was closed down, but I looked over and I saw a miniature shooting gallery, like the one that I'd seen when I was 4 years old. And I remember the voice of the Lord was so gentle, and what he said to me was, "Do you remember when we first met?" And I looked over at the Pacific Ocean and I just began to weep. You see, I forgot about God, huh? I forgot about God and I turned my back on God and I forgot about Him. But He never forgot about me. And I want to ask you today, do you remember when you first met the Lord? Is it still that sweet? Because let me tell you something, friend, He hasn't forgot. He hasn't forgot when He first met you. Amen. So you know what? After that, at the end of my time at the training center, they asked me to go and be a missionary in the Philippines, right? And so I was like, I went and told the pastor. I was like, "Pastor, I probably still have an open account of attempted murder. I'm not sure if I could fly out of the country." You know what I mean? And so I remember one of the pastors there at Victory Outreach, he told me, "Hey," he goes, "you know what? When I came to Jesus, I had a stack of charges like that, eh? And but when I came to God, they all disappeared, Holmes." And I was like, "Really?" I said, "I claim that for me." You know what I mean? And it didn't work out that way. That was his word. Come on, somebody. But you know what? So I said, "Let me pray about it." So at this time in my life, it was, if I go to prison, I'll serve Jesus. If I go to the mission field, I'll serve Jesus. If I live behind a dumpster, I'll serve Jesus. So it didn't matter. Honestly, in my mind, it was like, whatever. You know what I mean? I'm not afraid to get locked up, and I'm not afraid to go to the mission field. Let's do it. I just want to know what God wants me to do. So we went to the Brownsville Revival. How many ever heard of the Brownsville Revival? I hadn't heard of it at the time, but my dad took me out there, and it just happened. It was at the end of the Brownsville Revival, and it was the guy who was actually leading the revival. His name was Steve Hill, and this guy was an ex-junkie, ex-homeless guy. God raised him up, went through Teen Challenge, and now here he's preaching the word, and tons of people are coming and getting saved. Millions came and got saved at the Brownsville Revival, and so God was moving, you know what I mean? And so anyway, I went there, and I felt that, man, I didn't know that much that you could experience that kind of presence. You know what I mean? I'd been saved for several years, but I mean, the presence of God was so tangible in that place. When he called the altar call, people would literally run down and fall on their face before God. Come on, how many know we're going to start seeing that at CityReach Springfield, CityReach Kansas City, CityReach Banson, people running and giving their lives to Jesus Christ. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm asking God what I should do. Should I stay, or should I go to the Philippines, or should I go turn myself in? Should I stay, or should I go? And then a guy came up to me with a tape recorder. He had a tape recorder, and he gave me a word from God. I still have the tape, but he had a tape recorder. He said, "I got a word from God. God says go." God says, you're not out of place, you're in place. You know what I mean? This guy began to tell me things in my life there's no way he would have known in my past. He didn't know me, and things that would happen in my future. But God gave me a prophetic word through some guy at a revival in Pensacola, Florida, and so I did. I went. I went to the Philippines, flew out on my own passport, didn't get arrested at the airport. You know, God moved in the Philippines, planted churches in Manila, and started a training center, and God moved in the Philippines. And then after 2 years, I came back to L.A., and I remember people telling me, you know, these are Christian folk too, y'all. They said, why don't you just go through Mexico, you know what I mean, then walk across the border so you don't get arrested on those old charges, you know what I mean? I was like, I don't want to do that. Somehow that doesn't really feel like the right thing to do. Come on, somebody. But so I just flew in on my own passport into L.A. Sure enough, I was arrested on old charges. But I remember something. As I was preparing this message, at the top of my Bible, it was a reminder that says that the last message I spoke in the Philippines was from the farewell address to the Ephesian elders, that only hardship and prison await me. And of course, for Paul, that was for preaching the gospel. For me, it was for my own sin, for my own breaking the law. Come on, somebody. So how many know Jesus forgives? How many know the district attorney? Not so much. Sometimes there's consequences to our lives. But anyway, when I came back, I lived for Jesus for a time. You know what I mean? I lived for Jesus for a season, being locked up, but ended up getting released from prison. I mean, from jail. I'm facing 20 years in prison. I got discouraged. I fell back into my old life. For several years, I was tormented by demons. And I've told you guys, I would stick a gun to my head and want to blow my head off. I would see little demons running around me, laughing at me with voices of little children, a lot of demonic oppression. And I remember one time when I was like, God, I need to hear from you, God. And I just opened my Bible and opened a Bible that I had there. And I've said this before, but where we were actually smoking joints with the rolling paper, so a lot of pages torn back. Thank God Isaiah chapter 7 was still there, because that's what I turned to. And when I turned to that passage, Isaiah 7:9, and I said, God, speak to me. I opened the Bible randomly. It went to Isaiah 7:9. It was the first words I read, and it was, if you don't stand firm in your faith, you won't stand at all. And I was like, whoa. You know what I mean? I closed it up. But in context, that was Isaiah prophesying to the kingdom of Judah that they thought they were saved because they were God's people. But the prophet said, if you don't stand firm in your faith, you won't stand at all, meaning they would have judgment, that they would have captivity, that the temple would be destroyed, right? And so several years went by, and then I got arrested, and I got sent to prison. I went into literal captivity, but I'll never forget that when I cried out to God in the midst of my mess, that I opened a Bible and God spoke to me. I don't suggest do that all the time, you know what I mean? So there's this old joke that says, you know, someone was like looking for God to speak, you know what I mean? So they opened their Bible and it said, Judas went and hung himself. And they're like, oh no, that ain't for me. Let me try it again. Lord, speak to me. And then they opened it again and it said, go thou and do likewise. And they're like, no, that's not it. That's not it. And then they opened it again and says, what you're going to do, do it quickly. And they're like, no. So we want to be careful. You know what I mean? That worked that one time. And maybe there's some that we have a testimony that God spoke to you that way. But I wouldn't make that a habit. Come on, somebody. How about just study the word and do devotions and stuff? But so anyway, I ended up getting picked up. And you guys know the story. I went to prison. You know what I mean? And I kept doing the same thing, but ended up in solitary confinement for suspicion of bringing narcotics into the facility. Right there in solitary confinement, God wrecked me. Remember, he encountered me. It was like waves of electric that flowed over me for 5 months. My dungeon, you know what I mean, was filled with light. And during that season, God began to show me visions in my head of me preaching again, of me preaching in prisons, of me preaching in churches, of me preaching in stadiums. And I said, God, I said, you got the wrong guy. There's people that are smarter, people more eloquent, people that haven't turned their back on you. You know what I mean? And the Lord spoke to me clearly from Matthew chapter 20 and verse 15. He said, don't I have the right to do what I want with my own things? Or are you jealous because I'm envious? Are you envious because I'm generous? right? And so I submitted to the will of God. I served God. I was voted in as inmate pastor. You know what I mean? And during those times when I was in prison, there were a few verses that would continually flow through my mind. And they were, then the Lord raised up deliverers. And also, I am coming soon. So the Lord raised up deliverers. This was from the book of Judges, when the nation had turned their back on God. You know what I mean? Everyone did what was right in his own eyes, but God raised up some soldiers. He raised up some warriors. Some of them were from unlikely backgrounds. Some of them were from overlooked places. But God raised them up to do extraordinary things. And so during that season in prison, and I've heard talk to other people that have had encountered Christ in prison, just a lot of supernatural stuff that happened. And I'm coming to a close, but I want to just share a few more experiences with you. And I share these with you, and I feel like the Lord wanted me to share this with you, share sometimes when God spoke to me in my life so that you would be open to God speaking in your life. For some of you that are seasoned Christians, you've been walking with Jesus for a long time, this bears witness with you because God speaks to you. You know what I mean? I encourage you to allow God to continue to speak to you. In 1,000 different ways God speaks if we have an ear to hear. But on March 14th, 2010, this is after I met the Lord, I'd already got down to a level 2 camp. Come on, somebody. God is good. Level 2 facility from a level 5. Some of you don't have any idea what I'm saying. So, but a lot more freedom in a level 2 security camp than a level 5 security camp. I'll break that down for you later, David and Amber. So, David came up to me the other day and he goes, man, some people come up and they're like, man, I love just like the deep theological teaching you do. And then, but the other day, Dave came up and he goes, man, I just love it because I learned like the drug culture lingo and the prison lingo. On March 14th, 2010, God was speaking throughout this season very strongly, you know, just like supernatural stuff was happening. And so I thought I was going crazy. Come on. I thought I must have done too many drugs, and I'm going crazy. Because if I went and told the caseworker the things that would happen to me, they would lock me up and put me on some Seroquel and some more stuff. Come on. But so I said, God, I need you to speak to me. I need you to confirm this to me. I need you to confirm that it's you speaking to me and that I'm not going crazy. And so what happened is one day, that March 14, 2010, I'm walking the prison yard. How many have ever walked a prison yard before? Quite a few here. So I walk in the prison yard, and there was a dust storm that came up. This was in Las Lunas, New Mexico. Cherish knows about Las Lunas. A lot of dust storms, you know what I mean, that part of the country. So a dust storm came up, and what happened was that we were all walking, but they called movement. So you can only move once an hour. They called movement, and so they said, so you could move. So everyone went in, and of course I'm going in, you know, my shirt over my face. You know what I mean? To keep the dust out of my face. And what happened was I felt the gentle voice of the Lord. He said, hey, walk with me. Walk with me. You know what I mean? And so I said, all right. You know what I mean? So I just continued to stay out there. They called movement. Everyone else went in. And I was walking the prison yard. And just the presence of God was real strong. You know what I mean? And after about a lap, it all cleared up. And it was a beautiful day right there in New Mexico. And so the Lord spoke to me, and he said, a 7.2 earthquake will rock San Diego as a sign that I'm speaking to you. 7.2 for the year you were born. I was born in 1972. And so when I got back into the, they called movement again, and I went back in, and I said, I need to write this down, because I knew at that point that if God ever spoke, that he spoke that time. And if he didn't speak that time, then maybe the others aren't for real either. I said, God spoke to me that time. I know that for sure. I got in. I called my dad. I told my dad about it. I wrote three letters, my mom, my dad, and my brother, saying, hey, maybe sometime a 7.2 earthquake, rock San Diego. I don't know what that means, but I just want to tell you so that in the future, if that happens, I'm not crazy. And then so what happened was 3 weeks later, exactly, on April 4th of 2010, there was an earthquake in San Diego, a 7.2 earthquake. It's called the Easter earthquake. You know what I mean? And so what happened was I wasn't in San Diego. I didn't feel that earthquake. I didn't know about it. But the next morning, on that Monday morning, I woke up and my cellmate actually had, he had his earbuds in, so I couldn't hear the TV, but I saw the TV, and what it said was a 7.2 earthquake rocks San Diego. And I was like, I was in awe. This thing's for real. And I want to encourage you guys today that God is for real. Come on. That God is going to do what he said he will do. I've had some struggles and I've had some challenges since then. But guess what? I can never deny that this thing's for real. That God is for real. He is still speaking. He is still moving in the earth today. So here's the thing. I didn't go tell the caseworker. Come on, somebody. Because I would have probably got slammed down and kept in prison. But they would have thought I was crazy. But guess what? I'm not crazy. You know what I mean? God speaks today. God wants to speak to each one of you. You know, he's got a plan for your life. He wants to direct you. He wants to guide you. You know what I mean? He wants to walk with you and he wants to talk with you. God is still speaking today. And you know, as we began, me and my wife began to feel God call us to plant this church. You know, I've been here for 5-6 years going into the prisons, going to the prisons and jails. I began to feel that we needed a ministry like Victory Outreach where I got saved, where people could come out of prison and come into a church that they would feel welcomed. You know what I mean? That they could not only be accepted, but they could be used. Come on, somebody. You know what I mean? And so God began to move in my heart, and I used to go with Alan Thompson. Since 2011, I've been going into the Greene County Jail with Alan Thompson. And many times as I'm speaking to those 5 to 25 men, however many were there, I would tell them, we're going to plant a church in Springfield, Missouri. I would tell them, it's going to be a church where God's going to raise up addicts. God's going to raise up convicts. We're going to launch churches from here to St. Louis. We're going to launch churches all over the world from right here. And I would tell them this. I would say, when I was in solitary confinement, God began to speak to me about an army that he's raising up out of the prisons and the jails of this country that will go across this land and preach the unadulterated gospel of Jesus Christ with signs and with wonders following. And I began to preach these things. Come on. And then we would be going downstairs from leave the chapel, and I'd be like, what am I talking about? That's impossible. You know what I mean? I haven't even finished Bible school yet. You know what I mean? But God is faithful, and he has done what he said he would do. In 2014, I was taking a church planning class right here at AGTS, and I wrote a 50-page prospectus. I wrote it down. You know what I mean? And I shared it on Facebook the other day, but the 50-page prospectus, and in that prospectus, I talked about planting a church here. I talked about planting recovery homes in Springfield, Missouri, that God would raise up people to go to St. Louis. The first church I said we would launch would be to St. Louis in 2018. But now look at God. 1 year earlier, and not just St. Louis, but Kansas City, Branson, and 30 churches in CityReach Network across the United States. So God's on the move, and he led me to CityReach Network, and I could talk to you about how God did that, and we don't have time for that. But just let me tell you this, God has led me, that me being in the way, the Lord led me. And I want to encourage you guys too, that God is leading you. Man, God has you here. Man, Dino and Alicia, God has you here. God brought you here. You know, God brought you here, brother. You know what I mean? God's got a plan for your life. He's guiding and he's directing you. Sometimes you don't really see it all when you're up in it. But as you look back over your life, you can see, man, God led me right there. Even when I failed, God led me. God turned that around for his honor and for his glory. God is still a God who speaks today. And so we're excited about that, excited about what God's going to do. But I just want to, there's other things I could share, but I want to share one more thing about March 9th, 2014. So me and my wife lived at the camp right across from CBC on, what was the name of that road? Norton. Yeah, the road right behind Norton, one south. But anyway, James? No. But anyway, yeah, right across from Norton, you know what I mean, right there. And it was the day that Steve Hill died. So Steve Hill was the guy that led that revival in Brownsville, where God gave me the word to go to the Philippines. So this is March 19, 2014, and about in a few days, we're going to celebrate 3 years since Steve Hill graduated to heaven. And you know what? That night, you know what I mean? Steve Hill died, and it kind of impacted me. But I remember that night that I looked over at my wife, and I said, who's going to weep over the lost like Steve Hill did? And as I said that, man, the presence of God came upon me, and I began to weep, weep, weep for the lost. I rolled off my bed onto the floor, curled up in a little ball, weeping. And my wife came down and just held me. And I was just weeping for the lost in Springfield, for the lost in my country. And you know what? I know that was God's way of moving upon me to confirm, to plant this church, to do what He had called me to do. So I want to encourage you today to allow God to move upon you, Heather, to weep over the women that are coming into the home. Tom, to weep over the men that are coming into the home. To weep over the people in your city, not just your loved ones that need Jesus. Yes, weep over them. But let's weep over the lost in our city. Let's weep over the lost in our nation. See, there's other things that God spoke to me when I was in solitary confinement. And since we're beginning to see that some of the things, I believe that He's going to do all of the things and above and beyond all we could ask or even imagine. I believe that a revival is coming to the United States of America. I believe that God is going to pour out His Spirit like never before, where signs and wonders are commonplace, where cancer is healed. Come on, where the sick are healed, where the oppressed are delivered. God is about to pour. I believe, and I've told some people this, I believe over this past year and what we see at CityReach Springfield is the beginning of a genuine move of the Holy Spirit that will not just impact our city, but will impact this region, will impact this nation, will impact the world. Give the Lord a hand clap if you believe that today. So today I want to encourage you to obey the voice of the Holy Spirit. When you hear the Spirit speaking to you, I encourage you to obey. A way to get yourself in position to hear from God is to submit to God's authority and to be in intimate relationship with Christ so that you can trust the voice of the Spirit that you're hearing. So let me just get the worship team to come up today. And how many say, I want to be someone that's led by the Spirit? Most of you. So I believe most of us want to be led by the Spirit. We want God to speak. How boring would it be if God just created this universe and then left? If He's the great watchmaker in the sky that just created this thing and then just left us to our own devices, how sad would that be? You know, sometimes driving around, and I'm just driving around, going about my business, doing church stuff, getting errands done, and sometimes I'll feel the presence of God just fill the car. Hallelujah. And I'll just begin to weep in the presence of God. The presence of God is so beautiful, friend. I don't know what I would do if I didn't have the presence of God in my life. And you know, I went for several years when I was backsliding without the presence of God in my life. Let me tell you something, that was lonely. I was so lonely. I was so high, but I was so lonely. Can't nobody do us like Jesus. So I just want to encourage you guys today to hear the voice of the Spirit speaking to your heart. And you know what? Maybe there's some here today that what I'm saying, this sounds foreign to you. I'm talking about hearing the voice of God, the voice of the Spirit, being led by the Spirit. This sounds completely foreign to you. Maybe you're sitting there and you're saying, I've heard a lot about God. I even go to church. But as far as having a relationship with Him, as far as hearing His voice, that's foreign to me. Let me just encourage you today. That's not foreign. That's what this whole thing's about. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the issue of salvation. And so I want to encourage you today that maybe you're in this place and maybe you're a former addict, or maybe you never did drugs. But maybe you know that you lack today. You know that you lack God in your life. You lack hearing His voice, sensing His presence in your life. And so I want to encourage you today, if maybe you're in this place and you've heard a lot about God, but you've never had an encounter with Jesus Christ, where He spoke to you, where you gave your life to Him and you said, I surrender all, Jesus. Or maybe at one time in your life, like me when I got back from the Philippines. And I had been serving God, but I went back to my old life. I turned my back on God and went back to drugs and went back to my old life. But God met me in that in solitary confinement. So maybe right here, there's someone in this room that one time you were living for Jesus. At one time you were serving God. Maybe it was when you were a little kid. Maybe it was 10 years ago. Maybe it was last year. You were living for Jesus, but now you're not. And as I'm speaking, the arrows of God are flying throughout this place and they're penetrating hearts. You're not living the way you should, and you know it. I want to let you know that today's your day, that God's not here to kick you down and say, I told you so, boy. I told you so, girl. No, God's here to embrace you. He's here to pick you up. He's here to say, He's here to pick you up and place your feet on solid ground. So I just encourage you to bow your heads and close your eyes from all over this room. So I'm going to count to three. And when I say three, not until I do, but when I say three, and you want to surrender to Jesus, I want you to raise your hand. So one, you were living for Jesus, but you're not living for Him now. Two, you've never had an encounter with Jesus Christ, a time in your life when you said, you're my Lord, I make you Lord of my life. Three, you want to surrender your life to Jesus Christ afresh today. From all over this room, I invite you to raise your hand. You want to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. I ask you to lift your hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Anyone else? Three, four hands. I see any five. Any other hands? Six, seven hands. I see those hands. All right, let's all stand up right now. And so if you raised your hand, and you want to give your life, that you say, I want to come to Jesus and give my life to Him. If you raised your hand, I invite you to come forward. Let's give them a hand as they come forward. You raised your hand, I invite you to come forward. Come on. There was some from this section. You raised your hand, come on forward. If you raised your hand, come on down. There's a few other people. You raised your hand. I'm not gonna drag this on. If I remembered who you were, I would call you out. I just forgot who you were. But if you raised your hand, I invite you to take that next step. Hey, look, following Jesus is about dying to yourself. It's about giving your life to God. Come on, give her a hand clap. Following Jesus is about dying to yourself and living for Him. Coming to Jesus means I come and die. Not I come to Jesus so I can get a raise. Not so I come to Jesus so I can get a Lexus. Come on. Coming to Jesus and dying, no matter what that means, whether that means you go to the city and die or you're delivered out of the hands of your enemy, but whatever God has called you to do, but He doesn't give you an option, He says, come and die. Amen. So right now, I just encourage you guys, we're going to say a prayer together. Amen. We're going to say a prayer together. And we're so glad that you guys came forward today. Us as a community, we want to walk with you. You know what I mean? To do this thing, to live for Jesus. So we're going to say a prayer together, right? And it's not just about repeating a prayer after a pastor at the altar call, but it's about the cry of your heart to the living God. Amen. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, that you will be saved. So just pray with me this prayer. Say, dear Jesus, everybody, dear